So I'd like to welcome everyone to tonight's APA Town Hall, which is a continuation of last week's conversation, focusing on listening to you about the ongoing racism pandemic. So thank you all for joining us, and I'm pleased to introduce those leading tonight's conversation, APA President Dr. Sandy Shullman, APA President-elect Dr. Jennifer F. Kelly, APA past President Dr. Rosie Phillips Davis, and APA CEO Dr. Arthur Evans. To get things started, I'll turn next to APA President Dr. Sandy Shullman.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, good evening, and good morning to both our U.S. colleagues and our international colleagues. I want to start by bringing into this town hall the memory of George Floyd, as we remember and acknowledge his tragically shortened life on the day of his funeral in Houston. And I want to also honor so many other Black lives that have been tragically cut short. The conversation tonight is about us as a community and about us as an association. We're here as your leadership team to listen, to learn, and to share. We are making an ongoing, sustainable organizational commitment to find impactful ways to collaboratively eradicate racism, institutionally and systemically. We recognize that if we are going to go forward, this means we also need to look at ourselves as an organization and at psychology as a whole, both as a discipline and profession, to eliminate the racism in our own domains. As 2020 APA president, the theme of this year has been learn, lead, and change. Tonight is about learning from all the voices that we have and to share. And so we may evolve plans to lead toward real lasting change to eradicate racism in this association, in psychology, in this country, and across the globe. And now I'd like to turn it over to our CEO, Arthur Evans.
Good evening. Last week, I talked with my management team and I posed the question, is this Groundhog Day or is this a tipping point? And at that point, I wasn't clear on which direction our country was going to go, but it seems to me that this has become a tipping point in our country. And I think the question for APA is, what role will we play in making sure that we're not, that this doesn't become a Groundhog Day and we're repeating the same conversations and demonstrations that we've had in the past? So we've already identified at a very high level, a three-point strategy to move us forward around these issues. The first is to speak out and to advocate on issues of racial justice. The second is to see how we can use psychological knowledge, psychological science, to address the issues of policing as it relates to African Americans and people of color in general. And then the third is to make a long-term commitment to engaging around issues of race and racism in this country. We've already started that work. For example, we are actively, very actively involved in supporting legislation, writing testimony in support of important policing legislation that's consistent with our positions that we've held in the past, and we'll continue to do that. But we know that there is much more work to do, and having this forum to hear from our members directly is really and a really important part of that work. And so we're thrilled that you are on this call, that you're engaged on this issue. We want to hear from you. The ideas that we hear tonight will inform how we move forward, and we look forward to that. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Jennifer Kelly, our president-elect, who also has some words that she wants to share before we start.
Good afternoon and good evening, everyone. I feel honored to be part of this town hall meeting, part two. To be able to be here at this critical time in our nation and the world. We continue to be in the midst of troubling times. Although I am extremely distressed about what has been happening, I am beginning to feel more hopeful and encouraged that positive and meaningful changes can and will occur. I look forward to hearing from you as we move forward as an association. I am here to listen and learn, to help me to lead, to affect the change that is desperately needed. The question we need to answer is, after the demonstrations, what's next? Now I will turn it over to our immediate past president, Dr. Rosie Phillips Davis.
Well, thank you, Jennifer, and hello, friends and colleagues. And I too am glad to join in again tonight on this call and on this Facebook live streaming. Like many of you, I'm tired of Zoom, but I am not tired of hearing from you, and I'm glad you're here. And I spent hours today looking at the funeral with George Floyd, and I thought about it's too bad we didn't have a funeral for Breonna Taylor or for Ahmaud Arbery and for countless others. But what we are here tonight, and we want to hear what you have to say. I have to say, when I hear Arthur and Jennifer and all talking about a tipping point, I'm old enough that I wonder about whether or not it's a tipping point. Some of you may know, others may not, that I am a garbage man's daughter. My father was in the 1968 sanitation strike, and so it's been a long time. But I gotta say, I went to my first rally Sunday, and that actually is where I found some inspiration, because the young people who organized and led us were rising high school seniors. And they were adamant in their demands, and they were calling on us to do the right thing, and they say that they're going to do the right thing. So that does give me some inspiration and some hope. So we will listen to you tonight, and you will raise your issues, you will speak your truth, and you will help us get to where we need to be. I do need to remind you that luckily for us, 1,000 of you signed up. Actually, over 5,000 registered, and only 1,000 max, if we were to be able to let you speak, could be on the call. And many more of you, I'm sure, are going to be on Facebook Live. And let me remind you not to use any personal information tonight, because it will be on Facebook Live. So just be mindful of that. But I think speak from your heart, speak the truth, let us know. And then try to limit your remarks to 2 minutes, so as many people as possible will get a chance to speak to us tonight. On that, I'll turn it over to our CEO, Dr. Arthur Evans, so he will be our moderator tonight, and I'm looking forward to hearing what you have to say. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Rosie. So we're ready to hear from you. I believe we have some people already in the queue who want to make a comment or ask a question, and if there are, Alyssa, can we hear the first person that would like to speak?
Absolutely. We have lots of questions and coming in and hands being raised. So first, I'm going to turn to Tanny Deans. Tanny?
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, we can. Yes.
Hi, good evening. My name is Tanay. I had a question here. So it is paramount for the psychological field to join part in the movement against social inequality. You know, it is imperative for police precincts to consult with trained psychological professionals. Police officers need to be thoroughly evaluated and proficiently educated on how to interact and engage with members from varying ethnic backgrounds. Law enforcement agencies need the help of clinical professionals. So how will APA address the heightened need for culturally competent clinicians in effort to combat the war against racism? Will APA consider increasing public funding to students enrolled in APA accredited programs? Will APA consider providing more scholarships to students in doctoral training programs? An APA sponsored fellowship, dedicated to training students who harvest a passion for serving underrepresented minority groups currently accept less than 10 students a year, less than 10. So will APA consider providing more practical training that does not necessitate a stringent and competitive selection process? So I was just wondering if I can get some feedback there.
Okay, very good questions. I'm gonna ask, see if any of our presidents would like to speak to that, or would you like for me to speak to that?
Well, we were actually thinking that you could speak to that, considering sure. This is one of the areas that the executive management group and your staff really looked at with us.
Sure. So yeah, a lot of very good questions. And I think underlined, there were a lot of very specific and pointed questions, but let me answer the question in general. The issue around who's in the field and the cultural competency of the people who are in the field is a critical issue for psychology. And it's one of the things that we have been talking about and thinking about and really beginning to think about in a new way. It's something that APA has been involved in the past. We have a minority fellowship program that has put out and mentored dozens of psychologists who are doing extremely important work in the field today. But I think the bigger issue is who's in the pipeline and how do we help to get more people in the pipeline, and not just in the pipeline, but through the pipeline. That's something that takes an ongoing level of commitment. It takes ongoing efforts. I will tell you that one of the things that APA has been very involved in is getting funding for more doctoral students. The graduate, the GME program, graduate medical education program, which we've been able, or graduate psychology education program, GPE, we've doubled that funding over the last several years, or we've been advocates of doubling that funding. It's an example of the kind of commitment that we have to have and the kind of effort that we have to have if we're going to go beyond just talk and actually get funding for people to get into top programs and get through those programs.
May I add something to this as well? So last week, after our webinar, I heard from Dr. Jeff Baker, who's the director for the Association of Psychology Postdoctoral and Internship Centers. It's called APIC. And he was discussing with me what we were what we brought forth in the town hall meeting. And he said that to me that they will be certainly be interested in helping us in any way possible. So we have organizations who are willing to collaborate with us to help us move our agenda forward in really addressing the needs of society and in training of our psychology students.
And then I add one more thing. This is Rosie Phillips Davis. And what I'll add is that while APA actually generally is not in the business of directly funding students, and especially at the level our students need to be funded, we are in the business of advocating. And so we form partnerships with various organizations. We lobby with the federal government to make it possible for more money to be available to you. Another one, I know a number of our students take out loans. We lobby to get those loan forgiveness programs. You've heard about them and they've run into so many snags, but we are actively lobbying to make sure that people who go into public service can get those loans forgiven. So we've ramped up more advocacy and we're on it all the time. And so I just encourage you to keep pushing and keep letting us know, make sure that you are part of APEX, and then when you're out that you're part of the early career, so you can keep those issues right there on the front burner and keep pushing us to be even more accountable.
Well, you know, and Rosie, you know, as you say that, I was thinking that this past summer, summer of last year, I was actually one of the ones on Capitol Hill really advocating for the loan forgiveness program.
Yep.
And yeah, you were too. And I think that it was pretty well received by our lawmakers.
Mm-hmm. I'm also just going to throw in a pitch right now that also means go vote for people who see it the way we see it.
If I could join Atlanta, the polls are open till 9 o'clock in some areas. Not too late.
If I could just add one piece to that as well, as I think another role that APA has is to ask ourselves and our training councils and our training programs the really tough questions about what we're doing to move a positive agenda forward to eradicate racism. So there are informal things that we could be doing within our association. So as we partner with groups, we have to ask ourselves and our partners, are we walking our talk? Are we doing the things that we need to do? What's our action plan for going forward? And so I think another role that we have is a great convener and initiator of difficult dialogues about these issues.
Thank you all. I'm turning next to Abel Dean. Abel, you might need to unmute yourself as well. Abel, are you there? All right, we seem to be having some technical difficulties with Abel's mic right now, but we will come back. Next, I'm going to turn to Vernita Perkins. Vernita?
Yes, good evening, esteemed panel and attendees. My question is two-part. Are all the APA divisions being held immediately accountable for racism within their division leadership and division membership? Second question, what measures is APA's leadership taking to personally review and assess each division's responsiveness to racism and commitment to eradicating racism?
Well, those are two great questions. I will start off and say that we have plans for a town hall meeting with division leaders coming up in, I can't remember, Arthur, you may remember the timing on this. And that's certainly one of the questions that we're going to put on the table to all the division leaders and start that dialogue and start thinking about the processes we can use to hold ourselves and division leadership accountable. So I would encourage people, if you have information or examples of things that we ought to probe a bit further, we're very happy to have those and start this dialogue and start this process rolling so we can change some things very definitively.
You know, one of the things that we have is a division trio listserv, and that's the president, past president, and current president. And this conversation is going on those listservs. And one of the things they are doing that I have seen is sharing with each other the kinds of things that they are doing. So for example, Division 17, Counseling Psychology, was one of those first ones to start with actually having the white members of the division talk about what is it that we can do to get rid of racism, particularly against Black people. And so then I saw some others have begun to pick that up too. So I think a part of it is not a formal process, but what happens is that as we talk about it and people begin to learn about what makes sense for them to do, and when I say makes sense, that they begin to understand that we've got to be held accountable for this. A lot of psychologists really and truly want to change all this, but have not always done it, and we're beginning to find ways for them to do it. There are divisions do turn in program evaluations and whatnot every year. I'm not sure specifically such a question is provided so that they answer, but I do know that they turn in a report every year.
So Alyssa, I have a question from Facebook, this live streaming, and I will direct this to our CEO. What ways is APA collaborating with other disciplines like sociology and the American Sociological Association to engage on issues of racism in a structural, systemic way?
Yeah, well, I would say, you know, one of the things that we've been very intentional about doing over the last several years is taking our partnerships to a new level. If you look at how we've responded to COVID, for example, we have literally at least a dozen new partners in all kinds of areas. And the reason that we do is that we know that we have a very important kind of expertise as psychologists, but most of the complex issues that we work on are issues that require people from other disciplines. And that's no greater true than on the issue of racism. So as we are thinking about how we move forward with the three points that I talked about earlier, we're doing that being very intentional and mindful about who are the other partners that we need in order to do that work effectively. The last thing I'll say about this is that one of the things that we have noted, even our most recent work, is that While, again, we have a certain amount of expertise, when we partner with other organizations, we not only get a different perspective and other important information around a topic, but it also gives us the ability to extend our reach. So, for example, we are working with a number of organizations now around issues of race and racism, doing things on doing events on Facebook, partnering with organizations like Essence Magazine, because we know that those are the kinds of partnerships that are going to help us to reach and have the kind of impact, but also be informed by people who can help advance the work that we're trying to do.
The other thing I would add to that is that organizations like the American Sociological Association can partner with them to develop the full evidentiary base that we need for the levels of interventions we need to do to eliminate systemic and structural racism. And so I think one of the best ways we can join with those colleagues is combining the findings from our various scientific approaches in the social and behavioral sciences.
Our next question and comment comes from Yvonne Greer. Yvonne?
Okay, let me just see if I can do this.
I think you are here. We can hear you.
You can hear me?
We can.
Yes. Okay. Yvonne. Well, thank you for taking my question. I was just getting ready to write the question, but I'll just go ahead. Are you planning on having some training modules for other partners to be able to access on something like unconscious bias or whiteness as it impacts the achievement of racial equity? I work with the Wisconsin Public Health Association, and we did a resolution declaring racism as a public health crisis in the state of Wisconsin. And we've been doing work related to increasing awareness of the impact of whiteness on racial equity. However, some of us that's trying to lead those sessions are not trained ourselves. And so, to actually be able to, lead people, and I'm African-American, trying to lead a group of Caucasian people to accept their role in whiteness. So, to me, it is a psychological kind of a thing. And so I don't know if there is any thought of you being able to lead the effort and getting some information out there to help people in that area.
One of the things you're asking about APA in general, but remember, we also have a wide network. And one of the ways that I have found some states of doing it is turning to your state psychological association. So for example, last year I spoke at Minnesota State Psychological Association. They had their first annual multicultural conference and summit, and so they did that, and that there they put in some training. We also do have a national multicultural conference and summit that we avail ourselves to. So what we need to do is partner with our states and divisions and spread out that training, because APA itself, we will encourage it, but there hasn't been a specific training program. There are resources online, and we do have things like, and Dr. Brian Smedley is on the call too, and there are some things that we will do and make those resources available. I don't know, Brian, do you wanna speak to that a little bit?
Thanks, Dr. Phillips. We're assembling a bunch of resources in a virtual resource center related to our equity work with the COVID pandemic, Equity Flattens the Curve. So we'll have a range of tools and resources available. And as I'm sure you'll talk about later, part of our planning and work in our anti-racism work would be longer term work to change the narrative. And that necessarily includes training. So we'll be definitely harnessing the best of our science to do this.
Thank you.
I have a couple of questions from Facebook that I want to read out. One is from Jessica Mitchell, and she said, asked, are you partnering with the Association of Black Psychologists? I, Rosa, can answer that one. And then the next one is,
Please partner with the National Latinx Psychological Association as well. And that was Teresa Chapa.
Yeah. Well, you know, we do have we have an interesting partnership with several of what we call the ethnic minority psychological associations. And so one is through something that we call the Alliance, where we work together. And actually, there's a wonderful partnership that's going on right now that is in support of looking at the disparities with that have happened and have been so clearly revealed with COVID-19. And then the ABCI president is also president of APA, and so has joined with some of those kinds of things. And I love having Dr. Jackson on board, and she's come to some of those trainings for various kinds of things, and will bring a perspective that challenges us on any number of issues. And when I say us, I mean APA. We also have, as a part of our governance group, the Council of Representatives, we have seats on there for members of ethnic minority psycho associations, so they can be a part of helping us to formulate and govern in a more equitable and inclusive manner. We've got a long ways to go, but we certainly have come a long way from where we were. And there are other groups, and Jennifer, you might want to talk to them about Senator Haimi.
Yeah, I was going to just address a little bit about what the Alliance was doing, and it's the Alliance of the Psychological Associations for Equity, and so or racial equity, actually. And it's the American Psychological Association, National Latinx Psychological Association, Asian American Psychological Association, and Association of Black Psychologists. And one project that we did complete was we worked with the Annie Casey Foundation and really looking at the disparities within the juvenile justice system. Because one of the things that we note, and it was very clear in our research, that the juveniles of color were much more likely to have a diagnosable mental illness, and they were more likely to be incarcerated and for longer periods of time. And we are also engaged in the California Reducing Health Disparities Project with the Alliance. And of course, the project that we're engaging in now with them, looking at some of the things related to inequity from with the COVID pandemic. The CNE PAIMI is the organization that is really a committee that consists of all the presidents of the psychological associations, and APA is organizing that as well.
And if I might add, I'm sorry, Jennifer.
Yeah, and I was gonna say one last thing is that we are planning to have a meeting. Is that next week, Sandy?
Yeah, we reached out. I was just gonna add that. Reached out very early in the process to partner with the Ethnic Minority Psychological Associations. Our meeting is next Tuesday.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm turning next to Deborah Merchant. Deborah?
Am I unmuted?
Yes.
Okay. I actually had several questions, but I'll start with, I really like the way you phrased it, Mr. Evans, Dr. Evans, that about is this Groundhog Day or a tipping point? I'd wondered that myself. But you said it in a way that I really resonate with. Dr. Kelly, can you speak to what you are seeing or sensing that makes you feel hopeful? I tend to be pretty optimistic. So each round of protests or whatever over the last several years, I have thought, wow. And people speak to, we have to do lasting change and all of that. And then it hasn't happened. So what are you seeing that would have you say you're feeling hopeful?
Well, you know, Deborah, I have to be hopeful, because otherwise it's a place that I can't come out of, okay? And so one of the things that I'm here in Atlanta, Georgia. And so one of the things that we are seeing within our demonstrations is more,
we're seeing more white allies as part of the improvement, because we know that we can't do this by ourselves. I'm seeing here in Atlanta what we're seeing, some of the reforms that they're trying to start looking at and addressing within the police department. And really, I'm seeing an acknowledgement that and an awareness that there is systemic racism. And so with the first step, I think, is acknowledging it. And it's not just Atlanta that I'm seeing it, but it's all over the world. It's like, this thing has taken on something that I've never seen before. So those kinds of things have to make me hopeful that a change can occur. And the other thing is that if I'm looking at within my association, within APA, I can tell you that, and I've had served on the board for a long period of time. It was, and this is like my 10th year on the board. It was 1 year between. And this is the first time that I really felt that the board was really listening, hearing what's going on, and wanting to make a change. And I tend to fuss a lot, and you know, they can kind of hear my screaming, even though I'm not screaming, but they responded. And it wasn't just to me, it was what they are seeing, that a change is needed and that it can't be Groundhog Day. So I have to be hopeful. Otherwise, what's the point?
You know, Deborah, you asked that question to Dr. Kelly, and she's more hopeful than I am, but I will give you a couple of specific examples, and they are local and personal. So I work at the University of Memphis, Tennessee, and we didn't desegregate that university until 1958, which is not all that long ago. And yet, this week, we announced a scholarship that is a combination between the Shelby County School System and University of Memphis African American Male Academy. It's for junior high school African American boys that we will start to work with and provide a financial pipeline for them to go to the University of Memphis. So from keeping people out to starting even before they're in high school to get people in is a sea change. Now it's a small change, but it is representative of the kind of change that is there. And so even with my skeptical self, I can look to that and see that a change is gonna come.
I guess I would also add to that is that one of the things I have been struck by is the international aspects of all of this. The only way I can put it is I received a care package yesterday from one of our colleagues in Hong Kong in solidarity with what's going on here, and a recognition, of course, that they know very much what can happen when policing and government are oppressive rather than facilitative. And I think there is such a generational, by and large, very generational, worldwide sense that something needs to change. I really do see a difference between this and some of our other false starts before. So I am slightly hopeful. And like Rosie, I do remain a bit skeptical. But I figure we should start with our own house and our own stuff first and keep moving. And, you know, we'll see what everybody else does. That doesn't stop us from doing what we need to do.
Our next question comment comes in from Glenn Masuda. Glenn.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for the panel. To hopefully continue the tipping point discussion, I ask this question. Tragically, colorism is rampant within our own various communities of color. When I've openly addressed it, often the unfortunate response is to defend it as not being as bad as white oppression of black people. I understand it as a consequence of post-colonial white supremacist attitudes.
I would appreciate your comments and suggestions as to how to best address this dangerously insidious, unfortunate mindset, as well as the unacknowledged privilege within our own communities, with the hope that we would be more effective allies to each other.
Good. Who would like to, take that, Rosie?
Well, no, I grew up with that. Actually, you should go and find my TED talk that starts off talking about how when I was growing up, it was within my own community that folk called me black and ugly. But it is across, and the amazing thing to me is that it's within races, even across ethnic groups within races. I was in China where I had a woman carrying an umbrella because she did not want to get too dark within China. So what I like to do is speak truth to power. If you keep bringing it up and keep putting it out there, because it is not exclusionary and we have got a long way to go. But at least I can say it out loud. And I think that's what we have to do, is that we've got to call it when we see it. Somebody may have a better psychological answer, but my lived experience tells me that we have to say it out loud. We have to speak it out loud. And then we do have to remember where it comes from, that it still has to do with white supremacy, privilege, and equity, because we still have got to fight those battles even as we deal with the others that we face.
Yeah, that's what I would add. I think, I mean, the reality is that colorism is just another manifestation of racism, plain and simple. And I think it's important for us, as we're dealing with this issue, to deal with it in all of its manifestations. It comes out in our society in all kinds of ways. And the real challenge, and I think this is, and I'll just speak as an African-American man for a second, it can be overwhelming when you look and you see all of the ways that racism manifests in our society, from the economic to the social to the psychological to, I mean, there's no part of our society that's not affected. And if we're really going to address this, it can't be around the edges, because it's too baked in. It's too part of the DNA of what America is. And it's going to take a lot of not just awareness raising, but also changes in the way we behave and changes in policy. And I think part of that is addressing some of the attitudes and perceptions that we have based on, the unfortunate racism that's baked into our society.
I have two questions from comments and questions from Claudia Salazar. And it states, one is, it will be important to start deconstructing the concept of evidence-based treatments. She also stated, a lot of research in the field is conducted in university settings with white participants. No research outcome should be valid without a meaningful representation of minorities.
Well, I can kick this off and say I made the statement in the town hall last week, which is basically that I think when I talk about looking at our own house, one part of that is the questions we ask, the groups we sample, and the methods we use, and that we should be regularly looking at those and saying, where is the racism in those things, and where do we deconstruct them? I absolutely agree with that, and I think a scientific method is one of the places where we need to look. And that leads, of course, to the development of interventions that are based on those methods. So, while we'd like to think that our methodology is neutral and objective and all of that, we obviously know, and we've known this for hundreds of years, that it is not, and that we have to systematically look at other ways of coming to our sampling processes, generating our questions and doing our analyses, and also watching very carefully what conclusions we draw from those studies. And I'm hoping that the enhanced technology of big data which is a two-edged sword, which could enhance the inherent racism in research. It also could be an opportunity to be more culturally sensitive to specific populations and people, if it's done right. And that's a role that psychologists need to play, to be in those big data sets and those big data interventions, to make sure that we're asking the questions that tease out the inherent racism there.
And the other thing that I would add, because I talked about this last week on the webinar last week as well, it's also to partner with other individuals and others of our colleagues who do research in a different way. I mean, now we're doing qualitative research, something that I was never exposed to in my training. And I loved listening to one of our graduate students, a committee I'm on, and she talks about unsettling the process. Her research is all around the erasure of Black voices, Black women's voices in particular, because, you know, we couldn't be represented as women because we didn't represent all women. We couldn't represent it as Black because we didn't represent Black men, so to be silenced. So her process of looking at how do you unsettle that? How do you trouble those waters? And so we have to be ready to take on different ways of doing research and valuing that. And I think that we can honor that. So in our department, in counseling psychology, in our department, we are honoring that and saying, yes, let's let you do that kind of research. We're on that committee and we're supportive of that. And her work is so good. I know it's going to be a book and it will be out there. And that is the kind of thing that will inform us and help us get to more of the truth that's there, but hasn't been out there, because her work is not going to be a randomized controlled treatment variable, but it's going to get to truth that we can get to in the way that she is going to help us with that truth and deliver it to us. So yeah, we have to be there and have to be willing to speak out and to accept different kinds of partnerships and different ways of doing research and different ways of getting at the truth.
You know, what I would add, you know, when we started talking about this issue of racism and the role that we wanted to play as an association, one of the comments we heard quite a bit was, well, we need to look at our own house first. We need to look at the field and we need to look at APA. And I think this is a good example of an area where it doesn't appear on the surface to be a race issue, but if you dig into it, it really does have a lot of implications for perpetuating institutional racism. You know, to hear what Rosie was talking about, the reality, and I was trained in experimental, so I value and appreciate experimental design, but experimental design is a way of learning, is a way of knowing, it isn't the way. And one of the things that happens when we talk about research is that we talk about the gold standard. So anything less than a randomized controlled study is less than and not as good or valid as other ways of knowing. And the reality is there are limitations on what we can know and understand from that design. And frankly, there are other designs that can help us understand the same phenomena from a different perspective. And so I think we have to be willing to take on those kinds of challenges, because those are the things that go unspoken, but have a powerful impact on our field and have a powerful impact on how our field shapes our society. And I will say, though, that, and I'm saying this as a critique of the way we determine whether something is evidence-based, but I also think it's important for us to be critical thinkers. And I think it is as wrong for us to say that something that has been demonstrated to be experimentally or empirically determined to work does not work on other groups. That is an empirical question in and of itself. And my own experience has been that many of the things that have been demonstrated to have empirical support actually do work with communities of color. And I think that's really important, because we deny people things that have been tested and may work with them based on a philosophy Those are empirical questions, and the best thing that we can do often is to test out whether those things actually do work. But I think the overall issue around and critique of the design and how we learn and how we know and how we understand, I think that is absolutely valid, and we have to push back on that. But I think we also have to balance that with making sure that people of color have access to the best treatments that are available as well.
Thank you. Next, I'm going to turn to Danielle Hibbets. Danielle?
Can I? Am I heard?
Yes, you're heard. Yes.
Oh, my God. I can breathe. So, First, I want to acknowledge the panel and say I am so grateful to see three African Americans on the panel of APA. Dr. Shullman, I want to say thank you for holding accountability for your other constituents and other practitioners who do not understand. I can see that you've taken in and learned a lot from being in the position that you're in. I have written numerous questions, but I want to ask if it's okay if I code switch. And the reason why I ask that question is because as a clinical psychologist, a forensic psychologist, a statistician, someone who has done the research for African-American women and the psychological implications that it has on just us because of our hair and because of our skin, I wanted to collaborate with the Crown Act, but I can't reach the people that I need to reach. I want to assist on whatever task force that we're implementing in APA. My first question that I had has been addressed. When are we going to address the history, and why is there ABSI versus APA? My second question is about why didn't I have a Black supervisor that could understand the trauma that I experienced dealing with the populations that I serve. My other question is about EPPP, that test that is so much like the cognitive ability intellectual testing that we found to not be valid. I have so many questions. I just want to know, how can I be a part of making the change happen? I've written a book. The book that you were talking about, Dr. Phillips, I wrote it. It's entitled Her Story of the Hair Story, The Psychological Implication Hair Has on African-American Women. I've done the research. I want to help.
Well, thank you so much for your question and for your passion. And there were a lot of questions in there. I think Dr. Kelly, you might want to address the EPPP question that was posed.
Yes, and you know, and in fact, I'm part of numerous listservs, and this has been something that has been an ongoing concern within the in the educational community. For several years, I served as a liaison to the Association of State Provincial Psychology Boards. And now I haven't been there in the last couple of years, but I know that this is something that they are looking at and addressing. And I think that we have had colleagues, and many of them were the white colleagues, that have really questioned this and wanted to see a change with the EPPP and accountability with them. And so I think that this is something that they, 2 years ago, I know that they said that they were going to be addressing this, and I'm not up to date as to what is actually happening now. And if Tomas Granados is on the call, you can call in, Tomas, and give us an update on what's happening. He's the current president of ASPPB. But it is something that has been on the radar screen for quite a period of time.
Rosie, did you want to address any of the other aspects of that question?
I did have someone say that they wondered if people understood what code switch is. Can you tell us what you mean when you say code switch?
Yeah, I don't know what code switch is.
Oh, I think I do, but I want, was it Daniela?
Thank you, I was muted.
Danielle.
So code switching is being able to talk to my Black people the way I talk to my Black people without having to use my clinical language for others to understand my conversation.
Got it.
We appreciate it. I caught it. So
I didn't know it was code switch, but I know what I do.
I knew it was code switch because they did it to me early on, and yeah.
I have been up under Theopia Jackson, Robert Williams, quite a few of my ancestors that I stand on their shoulders. I've met you, Dr. Evans, serving you at the 50th anniversary for ABSci. I have done my work. Can I get in, please?
Oh. Yeah. So contact us, okay?
Yep.
Do that.
Yes.
Next, I'm turning to Alyssa Snyder. Alyssa, you may need to unmute yourself.
Yes. I was just wondering, in terms of actually working in the field, if you're in a work setting or if you are working with supporting somebody who's in a work setting that is not receptive or on board to even commenting on racism or acknowledging it, what options might an employee have to advance this important change?
Andy, our resident OD person.
Your IIO person said that goes right to you.
So what do we do? Yeah, what do we do with all the deaf people in the world, white people who are not paying attention? I think part of it does depend on the organization the person is in. I do believe, you have to assess what kind of support mechanisms already exist in the organization. Are there special interest groups? Do you have any organizational support systems for diversity, whatever? I think that's important. I think the other piece is thinking about what is it that you want to get out of a conversation or a feedback. First of all, is it safe to do it? And secondly, what is it that you want from that person? I just worked through this very issue with somebody today that wanted to raise an issue with their boss. And I said, is it that you feel a need to make a statement to be true to yourself, which is a very legitimate reason? And though, do you want something back in return? Do you want them to move? Do you want them to change? And so I think the question is, if you want to make a statement, it's one thing. If you want to work with them, I think there are some strategies you can use with support teams, but also to approach that person from a perspective right now of, I'd like to partner with you to make some changes. I think if you go in there and just basically say, everybody's racist, you're one of them and we need to change. My experience has been resistance increases. If you say, whether intended or not, here are the experiences I'm having and I need your help in changing that in our relationship, you might have a better chance of doing that. And again, you have to assess the situation and the person. And that's why a support system to help you do that is really critical.
You know, Sandy, I just had one of my colleagues who's not a psychologist call me today just before this call with and his colleagues. He was impressed with the kind of comments they were making and what they could hear and what they could not hear. So a couple of things, at some companies, you know, you can go to HR and some of them will have equity and diversity kinds of people there and you can raise it with them. The other thing is that it's just like those persons reached out to Sandy and me is reach out to colleagues who might be able to help you that you can talk it through with. You might be able to identify someone else that individual can hear in a way that they can't hear you. And the last thing that I would say is to make sure that you remember to take care of yourself because it's very challenging. If you're in an environment and people cannot hear you and will not listen to you and you don't have the support, So reach for where you can find those supports, because it didn't start today and it's not going to end tomorrow.
Amen. Arthur, you're muted.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah. Let me give you three pieces of advice around how organizations, things that organizations should think about. One is we know that one-off events don't work. And so I've been asked at times earlier in my career to do a workshop on, quote, diversity. And I've always refused those, because if the organization isn't willing to make a long-term commitment to these issues, it's not going to matter. It will be something that won't have much of an impact. So I think the first thing is to make sure that there is a long-term commitment. I think the second is to create a sense of safety. One of the reasons organizations don't take on these issues is because the managers and leaders are often afraid that it's going to, quote, mess up their organization. It's going to create all kinds of tensions and people being angry or hurt. And so people have to really pay attention to that and create an environment where it's safe for both people of color and majority people to be able to speak their minds and to not have repercussions. So I think that there are some things that are really important in how these issues are addressed and how they're designed that will make sure that they're both successful and safe for people to participate.
I would also add that this, from an organizational intervention perspective, I would be trying to identify white allies in the organization that might be able to be helpful, that could take some of the responsibility for this. This is not, if this is really a tipping point, we all have to take responsibility. And so hopefully there would be white colleagues that might be able to help you with what I would call the difficult dialogues that we need to have to move forward.
And one other thing, Sandy reminded me of something, is to define behaviorally and objectively what you would like to see different. I think the other thing that can happen is that there can be a lot of talk and a lot of processing, but nothing really changes. The people who are in the organizations, the behaviors that are problematic. And I think as much as possible, if you can help to define and quantify what the issues are, it makes it much easier for people to focus in on what they need to focus in on and what actually needs to change. And you have a way of measuring whether you're making progress.
Arthur, that's really helpful in the conversation I had today with this person. The two questions that I asked that they really focused, that I think helped them focus, is what do you want to get out of the conversation in terms of an outcome from that person? And two, what are the asks you're making that are something that they can hear and they can actually do something about, so we can see them acting on their agreements?
So I have a question. It's a question and a comment from Squaw Andrea. And it reads, as much as I appreciate the discussions about the recruitment of ethnic minority populations into psychology, I believe it is incredibly important that we increase our focus on how these individuals are treated in our programs. Many have been treated poorly, discriminated against. I would love to hear the panel's thoughts about how APA might create a formal process to allow learners to report such experiences and receive support without fear of retaliation.
Well, I think that there is a process for doing that for APA accredited programs. I don't know if Kathy Gruss is on the call, but if she is, we could unmute her. But there is a process for anyone who's in an APA accredited program to raise those kinds of issues, whether they're being discriminated because of race and ethnicity, gender, sexual orientation, and that does become a part of the accreditation process.
The other piece of that system, Arthur, is also that we can certainly encourage our site visitors and our accreditors to be as attentive as possible to those issues. I have no way of knowing to what degree that's an emphasis, but I would bet getting more uniform emphasis on those issues so that people understand that that is a serious part of accreditation. I think that's another way that we can be helpful in that process.
I agree.
Yep.
Dr. Kathy Gruss, who is APA's Chief Education Officer, is not currently on the call, but I would encourage anyone listening to email apawebinars@apa.org if you are interested in contacting one of the presenters or reaching someone, and folks at APA can help to connect you.
Alyssa, I want to say before we get to the next question, we have about another 30 minutes or so, and I'm noticing on our menu here that there are now spaces. So if you're listening on Facebook and you wanna get in and maybe even be able to ask a question, you can try to click on the link that you were sent earlier because it looks like there is some space now on the webinar.
Yes. And I have one more question. This is from Ron Botto. What can APA do to start impacting education, starting at the grammar school and high school level, required courses in prejudice, racism, et cetera? Also, APA needs to impact nationally the importance of requiring police training in this area. Military training would also be helpful.
Well, I think I'll start and then folks can jump in here. I think this is another example of where APA can partner. There are some things that APA can do quite well and perhaps not needing partners. This is another example, though, of where partnering would be really important and critical, particularly for those institutions and organizations that influence what goes into the curriculum of school-age children. But Rosie, Sandy, Jennifer, do you have anything else you'd like to add to that?
I'll just add a couple of things. Number one, we do have an association with high school teachers and community college teachers and that kind of thing. So we do have some partnerships there. And we also have partnerships with military psychologists, and they do an awful lot of training. And so I think some of it is there. We may not be as aware of it as we maybe would want to be, but it is there. So I would encourage individuals, if they really want to know more about that, to also use that email address about, what was it, apawebinars@apa.org, and you can have some more information about some of that.
Yeah, I was gonna say, for APA specifically, I think, and Arthur's right, I think the issues are big enough that we need partners for the larger system. But within APA specifically, we have both governance groups, we have divisions, we have all sorts of groups that focus, for example, the committee on teaching psychology in the schools focuses, we've just been passing model curriculum for schools. This is a place where we can intervene and really look very specifically at the kind of curriculum around racism and race that's being taught in the schools. And certainly our military division, Division 19, is very much interested in contributing to the training of the military. And so we have a lot of places that we can work that are resource people within site APA, but I think it requires that we also reach out and partner, as Arthur said.
So Ron, I hope that was helpful to you.
Thank you. Next, I'm going to turn to Greg Gormanis.
Hi, Greg.
Hey, Greg.
Hey, Greg.
Just quickly, I learned about code shifting. So as an Arab American, I'm going to be sensitive to that when I'm talking to some of my other Arab Americans. So I thank whoever that was for sharing that.
Do you do code shifting, Greg?
We did with Bridget Curry yesterday on a planning call. So I didn't realize that until I heard that phrase. Before I ask my policy question, I did want to say maybe we need another ECCP examination for the professional practice of policing. And that's really what my question is about. We license psychologists, we license plumbers, we license florists, et cetera. What are your views about requiring assessment, certification, and or licensing of police officers?
Well, I'll give my personal view. This is not an APA perspective. I love the idea. I think, you know, we give people a lot of authority. We give people the ability to essentially kill people under certain circumstances. That is a huge responsibility. And we are learning, and we know from not only the recent events, but historically, that not everyone who's given that that responsibility or that authority is trained properly to do that in a fair and effective and a just way. So I personally like the idea, and whether, you know, we could ever get a license or not, there's clearly some room for training and using psychological science and our knowledge to help influence that training and to help people to understand how their ingrained biases may impact and impede their ability to do their job in a fair and just way. And that's where we really want to focus. We know that there are areas where there is psychological science that can help. The issue is, how do we not just talk about it? How do we not just put out recommendations, but how do we partner with organizations that can actually help to make sure that that knowledge is actually integrated in a systematic way in police departments around the country? And that's the commitment that thing that we're making a commitment to right now, is really trying to lean into this and take the long view on this issue.
I would also add, I think concepts like licensing or something of that equivalent are really put into place, one, obviously to protect the public, and two, they represent minimal standards to get into professions and roles. And so while it might not be the way to get optimum impact, it could at least create a floor where people have to be at a certain level before they can wear the uniform of the law. So
yeah. And then I would just say that I would be hesitant about too many tests because of the inherent difficulty and discrimination in the testing. And so I think there may be some other ways to do it, and maybe there are some other ways that you would go about getting someone licensed. Maybe there'd be a certain amount of courses and whatnot that they would take, but certainly there are some models. I was listening to a man talking about the way they've changed policing in Camden, New Jersey, and gone with a more of a community policing format. So maybe there's some other ways to do it too, and that people can be certified or licensed that does not require us to go back to an old way that we know unfairly discriminates, and that is with those kinds of cognitive tests.
Performance.
Another comment, and it is really interesting on this one, and because I was talking to Rosie about this earlier today, and she was helping me out because I had an email about this, and this one is from Brad Black, and it says, how can APA advocate for more psychology PhD programs at HBCUs? HBCUs is historically Black colleges and universities, and I know that there's one in clinical psychology at Jackson State University in Jackson, Mississippi, and at Howard University. Is that correct? In clinical psych, do we have any more in the United States?
Tennessee State has a counseling psych program in Nashville, Tennessee.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the question is, how can APA advocate for more PhD programs at the HBCUs? And I can tell you what happened in Mississippi, because I'm from Mississippi, and the way they got that at Jackson State is that they sued the state for it. And so they had one at the University of Mississippi, and so that was a lawsuit, and that's how they got the program at Jackson State, is my understanding. Rosie, you want to take that further?
Well, really, when it comes to APA advocating for programs at any school and whatnot, it APA can encourage the need for psychological doc programs, but in reality, programs come about because constituencies advocate for those programs. So we have a counseling psychology program at the University of Memphis. We started that when I first got to University of Memphis because the people have to do it. So the institution has to want to do it, or the state has to approve it. And so people in APA can say, yeah, there's the need there, but in reality, no one should give up their power for what they're able to do. You can use alumni to help you fight for what you want at an institution. You can get some people who maybe graduated from undergrad from some of those schools to begin to say, but it does mean that going and getting a group of people at that institution to begin to fight for it.
Okay, Alyssa?
Yeah, and I just want to mention one more time, as Dr. Evans said a few minutes ago, that we do have space now in the webinar. So if anyone is listening on Facebook Live and did register for the webinar, you can click the link in your email and join the conversation. So you will likely be able to get in now. So please do join if you're able. This goes until about 8:30. And with that, I'm going to turn to Christina Fogel for the next question.
I actually am a grad student. I'm an African-American grad student who's in her 40s. And I've noticed that within schools that have AP structure, I happen to live in Pennsylvania, and there are a couple where you can get a PhD in psyche from, that there seems to be this big gap in understanding not only the cost for an African-American student who is of a certain age and has the resources to go to school and or does not have the resources to go to school. It seems to be that it almost leaves that population out of being a part of the conversation because of those resources. And so I'm finding, as I'm matriculating into hopefully a doctorate program, that there seems to be this very wide gap in understanding not only the need of African-American people within higher education, because I do work in higher education also, but also within psychology itself. And I feel as though a part of the issue in going forward for anybody that wants to go into psychology is that there's not enough funding. There's not enough programs that are geared towards the older or non-traditional student. And so it leaves a very knowledgeable, willing participant to be a part of that conversation about racism. How can psychology, that my question would be, in regards to APA, how would psychology support this population? Because everybody talks about racism and it's important and we need to progress, but I'm not really seeing a lot of changes to support the population so then that the need is being met in an educational, from an educational point of view. And so I think that would be my biggest question going forward. What is APA? Or what could APA, or what are you thinking about instilling going forward to make sure that these programs are looking for that candidate, will have the support it needs for that candidate that has the ability to put in the effort, has the knowledge, the heart, the empathy? Because what I'm seeing is there's a lack of that. And it's across the board.
Yeah, another very good question. I'm going to go to Dr. Brian Smedley, who oversees the Minority Fellowship Program. I'll just say before Brian gets on, I think the issue that you're raising about funding and support is a really important one. And I think APA has made some efforts in that in some ways. I think to your point, I think that we have to look at other ways that we can do that. I mentioned the graduate program that we that's funded through Congress that gives that we've been able to increase the funding. That money is going directly to psychology to doctorate level psychology programs. The minority fellowship programs addresses one part of what you are talking about in terms of the mentorship and support of people who are in programs. Another source of funding for particularly for research studies is the American Psychological Foundation, which supports graduate students, early career individuals, as well as others, but in particular graduate students and some of their research. And so I think that there are multiple ways that people can be supported out there. But I think to your point, we need to look at other ways that we can do that. Brian, are you on the line?
Yes. Yes. Thanks, Dr. Evans. Yeah. APA's longstanding commitment to the Minority Fellowship Program is clear. We have hundreds of alumni across the country. I'd also point out that the National Institute of Minority Health and Health Disparities at NIH also has a loan forgiveness program that many psychologists have taken advantage of, a very important program, particularly for those folks that have research careers in mind.
Okay, thank you. I have another question from Facebook, and I think that this will be directed to our president. Okay, Sandy. There doesn't seem to be a huge relationship between APA and PSYOP. So if somebody who knows what PSYOP is, so you have to tell them what that is. Are leaders discussing how we can work together to make progress in testing, assessment, and training? And this is by Erin Ann.
Okay. First of all, PSYOP is the Society for Industrial Organizational Psychology, the IO psychology community. And I can tell you that 3 years ago, even as I was considering running for APA president, I reached out to that community to be much more engaged with some of the priorities of APA. In this current situation, as this crisis has evolved, before I even had a chance to reach out to our PSYOP colleagues, they reached out to me and said, we've been doing work on policing, selection, testing, and we have a group of people that are working on racism in those processes. And so the president of PSYOP has reached out to both Dr. Evans and myself, and we are committed to working on some partnering on some activities about that. I think you will find that the relationship historically has not been strong, but I can tell you right now it's probably the strongest it's been in a long time. And our PSYOP colleagues are not only welcome but encouraged to be part of the solutions that we're looking for at APA. And I'm very pleased with those relationships. Georgia Chow, who's the current president of PSYOP, has done a terrific job in working with those issues. People like Fred Oswald, who has a lot of background in police work and police selection, has volunteered himself and his colleagues to help. So it's a very important point, and all I can say is we're working on it.
Thank you. Next, I am going to turn to Rima Jayakar. Rima? Rima?
Hi, thank you so much for inviting us to take part in this town hall. My question kind of piggybacks off of a question that was asked earlier by Alyssa Snyder, I believe, about how junior faculty or those of us who are early career or trainees can affect kind of actionable items, within their environments. And I appreciate a lot of the responses, but have a follow-up question around the fact that, you know, talking to my peers sort of throughout this week has made it abundantly clear that most people at their organizations, when they are trying to start these conversations, are either getting a non-response or a passive response full of sterile statements that don't even want to use words like white supremacy or police brutality in those responses. Or some kind of a very, psychology 101 kind of response of, oh, let's have a meeting to examine our biases, which of course is a good endeavor, but at this point in our journey is in some ways inadequate to just be examining our own biases. So I'm wondering, what is APA doing to foster this kind of leadership? Because in my experience and the experience of my peers, it is severely sort of absent or only there in small corners of organizations. And I think one of the things I heard one of the panelists say was, if the organization isn't willing to make a long-term commitment, it won't work. And organizations don't take on these issues because managers and leaders are afraid of a variety of sort of variables. I would say that 9 times out of 10 in my experience, this is the case with organizations. So what is one to do when confronted with this degree of systemic passivity, both individually and sort of what can APA do to foster the kind of leadership that we absolutely need moving forward?
Sandy, since leadership was in that question, I'm sorry.
Go ahead. What Rosie was going to start, I can jump in.
Okay,
after.
I think Jennifer can too, because you all can talk about some specific kinds of things. So I am going to also say something that's just kind of practical, and that is this: that what you're saying is true. That it is difficult for organizations. And one of the things I find in academia is that faculty don't claim the power that they have. Two groups don't, faculty and students. They don't claim the power that they have. So before I talk about, let them talk about what APA is doing, I also want to say, and realistically, if you're untenured, I think that you need to get tenured and you need to do the things that you can do to get tenured, because then hopefully when you're in a spot, then you will begin to speak up. Sometimes your faculty senate will do it, but I can tell you that I have heard from colleagues, and they have said that what they've heard around this issue is crickets, that nothing's going on. But when they're in an untenured position, that feels very threatening, and that threat is probably real. So my first thing is to have you do what you need and reach to the places that you need to get the support that you need so that you can become one of those people who speaks up. Now my colleagues can talk about what APA does and leadership training. And I do think that you can find some support with early career professionals and all of that in APA, but you also can talk about leadership and training that we offer.
Thanks, Rosie. Two pieces, what APA is doing, and then I think talking more about organizationally, I'm thinking in mind here specifically in institutions of higher education right now, although that's not exclusively obviously where the issues are. But we are working very hard on leadership development. One of the things we're working on this year is trying to create some core curricula that will be accessible to as many psychologists as possible and all of the leadership of the association. I have written about the issue of psychologists needing to be learning leaders. And I think one of the things we've done, for example, in many academic settings is sit back and watch and critique, but we have not acted. And so I want to make sure that our future psychologists have the skills and the tools they need to create action in organizations. Specifically to organizations, however, I think Rosie's points are very important about assessing your individual situation and your individual power in a situation. But I want to go back to something I emphasized earlier. Building a set of alliances and a network of support within an institution is absolutely critical, because those very leaders, once they recognize there's what we would call a critical mass, will respond typically. If they think it's just an individual, and I put quotations around just an individual, it's a sad commentary, but if they think it's just an individual, they can easily escape it or pretend it does not exist. When a persistent set of allies in various settings keep raising the same issues, they oftentimes feel like they have to respond. And so it requires a strategy, and it requires a collaborative strategy, in my experience, to get a lot of institutional change accomplished. So that would be one of the ways that I would look at that. And when I say allies, again, not just people of color, but white people who can have influential roles, who for both positive reasons, because they believe in equity, or for personal reasons because that's important for the leverage in their roles, they can be good allies to get things moving.
Yeah. You know, this isn't necessarily about that, and I don't know if you want to talk about LIWP, but as I look at the time, there is a comment that I want to make that isn't specific to the question. And it harkens back a little bit to may have been Danielle who said, why APA and ABSI? And here's what I want to say, is that I'm a member of all of those organizations, and they all give me something different. And they all help to support me. So we have APA, the Association of Black Psychologists, the Association of Asian American Psych Association, the National Latinx Psychological Association, the Society of Indians Psychological Association, of MENA, this Arab Middle East North African Psychological Association. I'm here to tell you that you can get nurturance and learn different things in each of those organizations. I love interacting with all of them. They all will react differently. Sure. And I know that we want APA to be a solution to a lot of things. It isn't, it has limitations, but we're in there fighting for the things we need in society, for our field of psychology, and for you, the psychologists. And I hope that you will continue to take advantage of everything we have to offer, but don't shy away, but make sure that you step up and join in. And you know, it's a cliche, but be the change that you want to see. We need every one of you out there. And the other thing is that we have this, so the town hall, so that you can say what is going on with you. And I know you ask a lot of questions and would like us to have a lot of answers, but I also want you to know that we want to know all the things that are going on with you, to make sure you connect with your other colleagues and friends, that you do self-care, because if you're like me, you get pissed off, you get angry, and had a lot of tears. Now, one of the things I said I'm better, and one of the reasons that I'm better is because I went back to claiming something that people say that we ought not to claim, and that is that I'm a strong Black woman. I am a strong Black woman, which enables me also to ask for help, but not to shed. And somebody said, how do we get here, and where's your hope? I'm the descendant of slaves, and I am not giving up. I'm not stepping back. I'm not letting anybody kick my butt without me kicking some too. So there.
I was going to say something, but I think that has to be the last word.
Yeah, I think that's probably.
I have to drop the mic on that.
That's a drop the mic moment, and nothing else needs to be said. So, Alyssa, we're going to kick it back to you. And I guess Sandy, I guess if you want to say anything before we turned it over to.
Can I say one thing? I just want to say thank you so much for all the information that you have given us, the questions, your thoughts, and I can tell you that we will be using this information in helping us to move the association forward so we won't continue to have Groundhog Day. Thank you.
And I'd like to thank everybody for participating. And I have this complete urge to just point to the screen next to me, which happens to be Rosie, and say what she said. And I've known Rosie for 45 years. We were in graduate school together. And I've watched the struggles. I've been part of the struggles. She is one strong Black woman. I love her. So thank you for putting a point on the evening. And saying it like it is, Rosie. I can always count on you for that. I love you for that. And thank you all. And we're going to keep working at this. As we said, this is to be a sustainable organizational commitment by APA. That's why you've got 3 years of presidents here. This is why the CEO is here. We're here to learn, then to lead, and then to change things. So thank you so much for everything.